So I don't think Dr. David Cohen needs any introduction. He's going to discuss on some psoriasis treatments.
Where are you going? Oh, my mic. Can I just use this?
That's fine.
Yeah. So I have to compliment the organizers of the talk, because you've certainly heard a lot about many types of products used for inflammatory diseases, many generics and many branded products. But many meetings that you go to, you're not going to hear a lot about traditional psoriasis therapies that have really been around for a very long time. We don't hear a lot about the data around them or their proper use. Looking at this list, how many of you here use any of these three products? And who would raise your hand if you go to these products before you go to biologic products? Yeah, a lot of you do, and I think that's actually pretty common in the medical community. What I will do today and now is just go through some of the background data on the efficacy that's available on these products and some of the safety issues. And then you're going to go through some biologics, newer stuff, and then we're going to break out into Q&A and some cases. But I think maybe we could take questions after this section, and then if there are cases, we can go through them. But I think if I were to pick one specific article for you to reference, it's probably the guidelines of care as they relate to traditional systemic therapies. I think that's a bit of a misnomer, since so much now is steeped in biologics use. They are traditional therapies as well, but when you hear this term, it tends to revolve around the three major systemic medications. And I've summarized them here. Cyclosporin, really able to boast dramatic improvements in psoriasis area and severity index with great speed. I think if we look at cyclosporin and what its major benefit to society, particularly as it relates to psoriasis, it would be the great speed at which you can gain control of really out of control psoriasis. And it happens to be one of those drugs that if you write a prescription for it at 2 p.m., the patient could have it in their mouth usually by 4 p.m., right? And it's hard to say that with a lot of other drugs, so that's an advantage. Acitretin, or psoriatane, is a drug that I think gets pigeonholed into a number of specific uses that we'll get into greater detail. I think some of the problem is there's a bit of confusion on what the proper dosing is, what expectations are regarding its speed of onset, and when to use it and when not to use it. Methotrexate, the granddad of all of the traditional psoriasis therapies, has been around for a very long time. You see on this chart a remarkable span of efficacy statements, right? 26% at 12 weeks to 64% at 16 weeks, achieving a PASI 75. The problem is much of this data is steeped in issues related to dropout, study design, and how old these studies are. I really scoured the literature to find something that was not commercially biased, and I might say I have no conflicts of interest with any of the drugs that I'm discussing in this section. And I really tried to find utilization of systemic therapies in the dermatology community. I could find nothing newer than this 2007 poster that was presented at the American Academy of Dermatology. And what it demonstrated was something very disappointing, I think. That despite the severity, the majority of patients are in green, the green bars, are being treated with topical therapy. So patients that have 50% of their total body surface area are still going to dermatology offices and being treated with, say, a pound of triamcinolone ointment and coming back a few weeks later and getting the same thing. And the utilization of systemic medications and phototherapy is really way behind what it ought to be, and is certainly way behind the corollaries that we see in the rheumatology offices. I think over the last couple of years, these data probably have changed, but still really, there really isn't good available information on that. And I think it We need to consider that when a patient has moderate to severe disease, what's the most appropriate choice of therapy, and that usually is going to be phototherapy or systemic, traditional or biologic therapy. Unless there's very limited disease, less than 5% of the body surface area, or 10%, in my opinion, of contiguous areas, it really deserves that kind of attention. I know this may be a rather redundant thing, and I like to discuss it because it's not something we really talk about in the office very much. I wonder, when you see a psoriasis patient, do you use any modification of these signs and assessments in your office? Or you can sort of nod or just tell yourself what the answer is. Do you rather in your notes write erythematous scaly plaques on the trunk and extremities, and then they come back a month later and you write less erythematous scaling plaques on the trunk and extremities or better, things like that. And I would suggest to you that using a modified PASI score, nothing fancy, but simply using a modification of scores that are used in the package inserts, the psoriasis area and severity index merely measures four things. One, erythema on a scale of 0 to 4, 0 being nothing, 4 being blood red. So 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. Very easy to tell a 0 and a 1 apart. Very easy to tell what a 4 is. We always have a little trouble between the 2s and the 3s, but that's okay. Scale is measured from 0 to 4. 0 meaning normal, non-scaly skin. 4 is an oyster shell. Right? 1 is a little scaly, and then you're going to argue on the 2s and the 3s. An induration means if you close your eyes, you don't feel anything. It's a macule or a patch. And 4 is a shelf, right? 4 is like a dinner plate right on the skin. And then 1 is barely perceptible thickness, and then 2 and 3 you can argue about. So while you're writing erythematous scaling plaques on the trunk, extremities, elbows, and knees, I would write erythema 3/4, scale 2/4, induration 2/4, and then the fourth component is assessing the body surface area. Use the rule of 9s. An arm is 9, the trunk is 18 in the front, the back is 18, the lower legs are 18, and the adds up to 90. The groin and the head are the remaining 10. So it's very easy to estimate it. When the patient comes in a month later on therapy, erythema may now be 2 of 4, scale is 1 of 4, induration 1 of 4, 15% body surface area. I've written so little, it took such a little bit of time, yet anyone in the audience can pick up my note and know exactly how much psoriasis is there. I'm not asking you, as in the PASI score, to weight areas. This one has more surface area. But you get a very good vision of the way a patient is moving. And number two, the note has all the information the insurance company needs for pre-authorization, because they need to know that sometimes. So when you see PASI scores, the PASI improvement, a PASI 75, doesn't mean the patient is 75% better. It means that the numerical score from erythema scale, induration, and body surface area has dropped 75%. In a more vernacular sense, it means the patient has gotten clear or nearly clear or almost clear, right? Substantially improved. The global assessments are really, again, more street-like terms. You're clear, you're mild, you're severe. And then the life quality indices are fixed questionnaires that discuss impacts on ability to perform activities of routine daily living, how they feel about their psoriasis, and how it impacts their quality of life. And these are much more difficult things to assess, have much greater variability, vary from country to country and how people react, but they move with the PASI score at least on the way down, maybe not on the way up the same way. So methotrexate's been around since 1972. Guidelines have been published twice. It's indicated for psoriasis, so it's on label, right? I don't have to make a statement that I'm going to be discussing off label. These are on label uses of the drug. And there's no surface area described. And it can be used for really all forms of a psoriasis. The way it's thought to work is by interfering with dihydrofolic acid reductase. It's an enzyme critical in DNA synthesis. So you need a lot of DNA synthesis if you're making a lot of skin cells and a lot of lymphocytes, and it interferes with that. We thought that's how it worked for 30 years. And it still works that way, but there are other pathways that are independent of that that will allow it to work as an anti-inflammatory agent, as an immune-modifying agent, despite the fact that we have patients take folic acid with it on a regular basis, which ought to foil the way it works, but it doesn't. So how well does it work? In 1972, it gets approved for psoriasis, and we wait 32 years to find out really how well it works. And it was by happenstance. It was by methods which we would have not expected, but the European Union asks that drugs that are approved in Europe not be only compared to a placebo. In fact, they frown on placebo control, whereas in the US, we relish placebo control, but they want an active comparator. And methotrexate was a logic active comparator for Humira or adalimumab to get approved. So in this study, there is a methotrexate arm, an adalimumab arm. And it's the first time using PASI scoring, because it's still a more modern incantation of psoriasis severity measurements, we get to see how methotrexate works. Now keep in mind, this could be a little tricky looking at the graph, but one axis is the dose. So they're finishing at about 20 milligrams, but they're starting at 10 to 12 and a half milligrams and working their way up based on their response. So when you look at the PASI scoring at week 16, it doesn't mean they've been riding on 20 milligrams the whole time. So you have to really read into it a little bit. But what you're seeing by week 16, a third of the patients are getting a PASI 75 or roughly clear or almost clear, which is really quite good. Of course, if you compare it to a really stellar biologic drug like adalimumab, it doesn't nearly do as well. But I think more time is needed at the dose that it was on to get a fair comparison of how well it was doing. Remember, the adalimumab was at full boat, full board from the beginning, and methotrexate was building up. But it's the first time we get an idea of how well methotrexate is doing. It is an effective medication, and I think we'll all agree, a very accessible medication for psoriasis. There are a couple of absolute contraindications for this drug that, you know, you really don't have any room around. One is pregnancy. Methotrexate is an abortifacient, so you can abort a pregnancy by putting it on board or certainly interfere with fetal development. It's passed along when nursing, so that's a contraindication. And if someone has a really severe hematologic abnormality, severe anemias or pancytopenias, I consider this a kind of absolute contraindication. It really depends on the severity, and it depends on the nature of their hematologic disorder and how well the hematologist will follow along with you. Then there's a very long list of relative contraindications I'm sure many of you are aware of. This isn't the kind of drug you start on a patient in the clinic that you've never seen before. You have no idea how reliable they are. You have no idea if they'll come in for follow-up, and you don't know what their drinking history is. I make sure I understand the patient, and I know that they're going to come back before I put them on methotrexate. I'm reticent, not absolutely. Depends on the patient. But the new patient who's 17 or 18 years old, who's graduating high school and going off to college, may not be the perfect person for methotrexate, since I hear that kids in college drink. That's what I hear. I have two in college, and my angels, I'm sure, are not doing that, but their friends are. So severe kidney disease, liver disease, diabetes, not an absolute contraindication, one that you have to consider if the patient is obese, it predisposes them to fatty liver, and fatty liver and methotrexate may accelerate fibrosis. I've mentioned some of these other things. Immunodeficiency is a relative contraindication. There are patients with HIV or other immunodeficiency syndromes where you may need to use this. Recent vaccination, I mean very recent, right? Not like 3 weeks ago, but just a few days ago. and consider contraception longer in men than in women, right? Because it does affect spermatogenesis. I usually have guys stop 2-3 months before they're contemplating pregnancy, and women, I have one ovulatory cycle. I'm trying to be safe at least 2 months. So the toxicities are myelosuppression, hepatotoxicity, and pulmonary fibrosis. Those are the major things we have to look out for. Myelosuppression or pancytopenia is going to be one of those things that'll occur acutely. You have to act very quickly. You often learn about it when the patient is in the ER, they're septic, or they're acutely febrile, or they're just really doing very poorly. So if you have a patient on methotrexate that has an acute change in their health status, you really need a stat CBC to what's going on. We tend to see it happen acutely with bad drug interactions, so patients may get sick from methotrexate and not from methotrexate. An unknowing primary care gives them Bactrim, and you've really set off a chain of events that could make this a big problem. The same with a lot of NSAIDs. Now you might say, well, the rheumatology patients are always on NSAIDs when they're on methotrexate. That's true, and I think it's just something you have to monitor and be more cautious about. High creatinines where the clearance of methotrexate may be impeded, older patients where clearance is impeded, I think you ought to use folic acid supplementation. Certainly controversy whether people take it on the day they take their methotrexate. For simplicity, I have people take it every day. Albumin may reflect a liver disease, and usually you'll see acute hematologic problems early on in the first 2 months, unless there's a drug interaction that it can occur any time. So the hepatic side effects are either reversible through non-aggressive fibrosis or serious from cirrhosis. And in the old days, when this was the mainstay, this was not an uncommon set of situations to come across. Certainly when I was a resident, we had to take care of patients who had methotrexate-induced cirrhosis. I see it a lot less now because we have so many more choices, right? And there's very low risk when you're under basically 2 grams of methotrexate. The liver biopsy is the gold standard. It's very hard for me to remember the last time I sent someone for a liver biopsy despite prolonged use of methotrexate because the guidelines change and extend the amount we can use, and then we have other choices we can change them to when the dose gets to a certain point. The pulmonary issues are a bit tough. In my interrogation of patients on follow-up, I usually ask any fever, any infections, any cough, any respiratory infections, any diarrhea, hair loss, mouth sores, things like that. I'm trying to get at the big issues that come with methotrexate. So pulmonary effects are idiosyncratic. They can be acute. They could be chronic gradual pulmonary fibrosis. And we work that up initially with a chest x-ray, although you're really going to need to send someone to a pulmonologist if you suspect it. There doesn't seem to be really an increased risk of malignancy in psoriasis patients taking methotrexate. I've already mentioned the gastrointestinal findings, which can occur. I don't think this is necessarily a reason to stop methotrexate if the nausea or anorexia are mild. If the ulcerative stomatitis is severe, you got to pull back. Sometimes I use folinic acid rescue after a day of methotrexate. And of course, the reproductive effects I've mentioned already. So when you start, complete blood count, comprehensive metabolic panel. I like to get hepatitis serologies on most patients I'm going to start on systemic therapy. Do most of you do that? I think it's a good idea to file that away. I just have, not making it up, 3 weeks ago, am working up a patient with a lichenoid dermatitis, trying to figure out what's going on. The biopsy did not come back lichenoid. It looked like lichen panis. She had hepatitis C. She had 500,000 copies of hep C RNA per cc of blood, and she didn't have a speck of change on her liver function test. She was low normal, and when getting the history, it sounds like she might have got hep C about 30 years ago and had no idea, and all of a sudden you start an immunosuppressive therapy or maybe methotrexate, and you're uncoupling this detente that the immune system has with the hepatitis C. So get that workup. I don't get HIV tests unless I'm suspicious, and probably we're not suspicious enough. pregnancy tests on women of childbearing potential. PPD, I don't often get with methotrexate, but starting to do it a bit more of late because sometimes I'm going to add a biological on, and I don't want to have to wait for it. So most of the time, I think in this country, people are given methotrexate PO. So they're given as oral tablets. They're available in 2.5 milligram tablets, widely available, inexpensive. I almost always deliver methotrexate sub-Q. And either do it, I've been doing it for years this way. I think it's my personal bias of improving GI side effects, improving safety, because if you give someone a 1cc syringe, the most that they can use is 25 milligrams. You avoid first pass effect, right? So they're not going through the liver on the first pass. You're getting full dose, and there's some evidence to suggest greater efficacy in the rheumatoid patients. It's available now as a commercial product, as a sub-Q self-contained delivery system. I think that's fine too. This is something I think folks ought to consider, since we're having so many patients deliver subcutaneous drugs on their own. Methotrexate is easy to do that, and usually people won't forget if they gave themselves an injection, as opposed to forgetting whether they took their methotrexate tablets or the day they take it, and that's when people get in trouble with hematologic suppression. Those are the ones that I have ran into over the years when people get pancytopenia. They've taken too much, or they've misunderstood our instructions to take it once a week and they take it every day. That happens. So do folic acid supplementation, a milligram daily. Folinic acid or leucovorin, you know, it's something that you kind of remember exists. It's the only drug I could think of in dermatology where we have an antidote to misuse. It's a real antidote, right? So it comes in 5 milligrams, but it comes in larger tablets. And if you think someone's in trouble, and it's happened to me, where someone calls you from, they're in Aruba, they're in Europe, they're on methotrexate, and you think something bad is going down, you can ask them to get folinic acid or leucovorin. Take it, and you could sort things out later. Oftentimes, you're finding out about this on the weekend. You're finding out about this late at night. You don't know what's going on. Do leucovorin rescue and get your CBC in the morning, or send them to the ER. Depends on the severity of what's going on. But you can give 20 milligrams out of the gate and every 6 hours if you have bona fide bone marrow suppression. And the earlier you act, the more you're going to be able to reverse the effects. And I'll use it sometimes to mitigate the side effects of methotrexate, particularly if someone's doing really well or they can't afford any of the other drugs. So we'll use folinic acid, leucovorin, maybe 5 milligrams the day after they take it. And it can really cut down on hair loss and nausea and vomiting and diarrhea. So just remember that, because that could save you. So everyone has their own way of doing this. How often do you get bloods? Yes, I think every 2 weeks for the first few 2 weeks periods are fine, and then every month for a couple of months, and then every 3 months when people are quite stable, and that really keeps people engaged in their treatment, and it doesn't overtax them by having them get blood tests every month for years. It just doesn't seem necessary, but always remind them not to take other drugs unless they're sure they're okay. With taking it with methotrexate. Liver biopsies, every year we get to postpone liver biopsies. In the setting of normal liver functions, we're looking at 3.5 to 4 grams. Think of how many years it takes. It takes 3, 4, 5 years to get there. And by then, Leon's going to have another new drug in psoriasis to talk to us about at the meeting. So we're going to have so many new choices to deal with after you get to this point, right? And insurances, God knows how frequently they change every 3 to 5 years. So new things will be covered while old things aren't. So it's a highly utilitarian medication to be familiar with and to be happy giving. So it's not a mutagen, but it's a pregnancy category X. It is a teratogen, and you know, don't use it when women are really considering getting pregnant. Just avoid that, get away from it. That is an issue with many of the oral psoriasis medications. I mentioned Bactrim, NSAIDs, statins. Again, not an absolute contraindication, but statins interact with a lot of drugs. You have to monitor them for liver toxicity, and will you increase the risk of rhabdomyolysis? Will both of them cause that to happen? And again, just if you're not sure, do blood tests more frequently. It lets everyone sleep better at night. Just get those CBCs and comprehensive metabolic panels a little more frequently in the beginning. So it's well tolerated in kids. It's in the atopic dermatitis guidelines of care as one of the major systemic drugs to be used in children and adults with eczema, and it's used in children with eczema and psoriasis. And it's also one of those drugs we tend to go to when we have those complex clinical scenarios. Someone has a malignancy. Someone has metastatic malignancy, and they have bad psoriasis. What drug can we go to, since it's a bit of a bugaboo with the biologics sometimes? We'll still use them under certain circumstances, but methotrexate may be that drug that we feel most comfortable going in those difficult scenarios of malignancy. Acitretin or psoriatein. So the oral retinoids have been around. Tegasan was introduced in 1986 in the United States and was replaced rapidly by psoriatein. The problem is, early on, many of you here may remember Tegasan or etretinate has a very, very long half-life, like 4 months is the half-life from a single dose of Tegasan. And the idea was, can shorten the half-life and make this a safer drug, and that's why psoriatein or acitretin was developed, had a shorter half-life. But the conversion from the old dosing to the new dosing created a lot of distress. So people were coming out and using psoriatein of 50 milligrams per day. It was positioned as a quick-acting oral retinoid. Now keep in mind, 1986, what did we have? We had methotrexate and we had cytotoxic agents that we used in cancer. This was a godsend, right? This seems like sort of old-fashioned medicine, but it was a tremendous advance for us. Right, this is what acitretin looks like, but it has a high incidence of dose-dependent side effects. It seemed like it worked pretty well. At 50 milligrams a day, which I could tell you most people cannot tolerate, it seemed to provide a PASI 75 of about half, and even a greater amount at 1 year. But you notice patients were dropping out of this study pretty quickly. So only the survivors of the study, we call that survivor bias. It doesn't mean the other patients died. It just means survivorship in a study means you've hung in there and have remained on protocol for the duration of the study. It's hard to stay in this study. If you did, you did well. But if you didn't, we don't know how well you did. And just get a glimpse at the dose-related side effects compared to low dose. So chylitis was nearly universal, right? How many of your Accutane patients, your isotretinoin patients, don't come in complaining of dry lips? Well, you ain't seen nothing yet until someone's on 75 milligrams of acitretin. But what's really disturbing to most people is the high degree of hair loss. And the hair loss is diffuse thinning, like clumps of hair coming out when you're combing it. And it's just not tolerated. Peeling, arthralgias, dry skin, these are really all in high prevalence at the higher doses and drop considerably when you lower the dose to a more manageable effect. However, when you lower the dose to a more manageable side effect profile, so down did your efficacy go. So it has a broad label. The label is in basically psoriasis. Right, so you don't really have to pick which psoriasis type you want to use it in. And if you look at a conglomeration of studies and reviews, you see all the different types of psoriasis mentioned. I think during the discussion and maybe during your Q&A, we could talk about this a little more. In erythrodermic psoriasis, it can be used. I think it's a little slow in onset. Pustular psoriasis and palmar plantar psoriasis, I think, is when it shines as an agent, right? Those are key areas of use. And then when it's used in plaque psoriasis, I think it tends to be used most as an adjuvant therapy, not as a solo therapy. And I think this may be its single best use in plaque-like psoriasis. It's combination therapy with ultraviolet B light. Ironically, there's a UV warning in the psoriatane label. There is a warning about ultraviolet light. But the standards of care all across the world, discuss the concomitant use of acitretin with ultraviolet B therapy and UVA therapy. But you can appreciate this huge difference. Delivering this being broadband UVB, getting about a quarter of patients pretty much clear, almost clear, right? Versus adding acitretin at 25 to 35 milligrams, more than doubling the efficacy. So you really can supercharge your phototherapy with acitretin. These are patients who failed UVB monotherapy, and when acitretin was added, right, the combination of the two really got a lot of patients clear. So I think this is really where acitretin is most useful. It is replete with side effects that I think for the most part are rather manageable. The mucocutaneous side effects like chylitis and conjunctivitis and hair loss are really going to be dose dependent. If they occur in their bolusim, you got to either discontinue the drug or lower the dose. This is a teratogen. This is a category X bona fide teratogen. I do not think this drug ought to be used in women of childbearing potential, right? It is not labeled as such. It has a warning that if it's used in women of childbearing potential, you need to wait 3 years before you contemplate pregnancy. I have a hard time keeping people from getting pregnant for a month on isotretinoin. And, you know, once they stop a therapy, they're kind of on their own. I don't know how you're going to control someone for 3 years. So in my book, women of childbearing potential ought not to be using acitretin. So rather, this is a treatment for men and postmenopausal women. The exceptions will be in rare inherited disorders of keratinization where you need to use these drugs in infancy or for a lifetime. The terrible lamellar ichthyosis patient. But those aren't going to be the ones you're going to see every day, and they're likely going to be taken care of by uber specialists in pediatric dermatology who specialize in genetic disorders. For me, you stay away from women with childbearing potential with this drug. The other issue is if you drink on psoriatane, you back convert this back to etretinate and expand its half-life greatly. So skin infections can occur because of the drying and cracking. Photophobia, like retinoids can do. Diffuse interstitial skeletal hyperostosis is possible at higher dose. Longer-term studies seem to demonstrate that that's not the case with the lower dose. And the odd, but I've seen it, the pyogenic granulomas can occur on this. They can occur around the cuticles or in other areas where trauma occurs. If they come up, be aware of it. Treat them like any pyogenic granuloma. If they're becoming eruptive, that's a good reason to get off the drug. So I mentioned some of these already. You know, avoid alcohol. But really, it doesn't matter as much in men or postmenopausal women if they have a little alcohol. I don't think people should be heavy drinkers on this drug. So long-term safety, you follow liver function tests. There's no reason or cause to do liver biopsies. You do have to follow lipids. Acitretin really can affect lipids in a dose-dependent fashion. So hypertriglyceridemia is something you see, as well as elevations in cholesterol. So I've mentioned this already about DISH. Baseline monitoring, physical history, of course, pregnancy test, but you really ought not to do a pregnancy test because you should never be using it in someone who you need to get a pregnancy test on. CBC, comprehensive metabolic panel, and lipid panel. And those are the things I think you need to follow. So you can follow those every 2 to 4 weeks early on, and then after a few months, monthly, and then every 3 months. Lastly, I'm going to conclude with cyclosporin. So cyclosporin, in an ironic way, is a natural product, right? It's a fungal derivative. This grows in the soil through fungi. It is an undecapeptide that's really a remarkable drug. And if you really look back at our history of understanding psoriasis, I was a resident in 1990, okay, and I was still taught that psoriasis was a disorder of hyperproliferating epidermis. The skin was just turning over quickly, and that the drugs we had for psoriasis tamped down a hyperproliferating epidermis. That's where all that scale came from. Until cyclosporine. Cyclosporine changed everything, because cyclosporine was originally used to prevent the rejection of allografts, so kidney transplants, liver and heart transplants. It was the thing that revolutionized transplant medicine. And a couple of patients got transplants that had psoriasis, and their psoriasis cleared. And that was remarkable, because cyclosporine has no impact on epidermal cell kinetics. So how could it possibly work for psoriasis? And it was our first peering into the immunologic effects of the immune system as a cause of psoriasis, and how important it was. And it really wasn't just an epidermal disorder, it was an immunodermatology disorder. And it was discovered through this drug. So it blocks calcineurin, which is important in elaborating very important, very proximal inflammatory signals, namely interleukin-2. It really doesn't get higher up than interleukin-2 in psoriasis, so that's a really important one. It's highly utilitarian drug. It's rapid onset. It's given orally, typically at 2.5 to 5 milligrams per kilo per day. Usually I do it in two divided doses. It's available generically and brand in 25, 50, and 100 milligram capsules. Keep in mind that most of the cyclosporin that we write, and I think ought to write, is modified cyclosporin. That means it's been altered to have more even bioavailability, and it has a very short terminal half-life. So if things go wrong on cyclosporin, stopping the drug allows it to wash out very quickly, right? Five half-lives is less than 2 days. Really, most of it's out at the end of the day. So it's practically used for moderate to severe refractory psoriasis. Treatment duration, probably less than a year to two. And it has remarkable efficacy. These are some of the original studies done from the New England Journal demonstrating the biggest advance in psoriasis therapy in a half a decade, right? Look at these sort of clear, almost clear. This is the pre-PASI data, and it's at week 8. And we're seeing tremendous effects of cyclosporin. And by the way, when was the last time you saw a biologic show you 8-week data as its primary endpoint? Doesn't have to, but it's pretty fast onset. So if you compare methotrexate to cyclosporin, in some studies they look pretty similar. The one problem here in this New England Journal paper, about a quarter of the methotrexate people dropped out because of liver function abnormalities. So this is survivor bias. Only the people who stayed in the methotrexate study were counted. So works pretty quickly. I can't give you PASI data the way you want it, because we just don't have those studies. But it really does work in the realm of the biologics. The problem is it has its fair share of side effects that limit its utility to be used for prolonged periods of time. And cyclosporin does not cure or put psoriasis into remission, right? It's nephrotoxic. It can cause interstitial fibrosis of the kidneys. It basically causes them to scar down. It causes hypertension, and it could predispose to certain malignancies, although general malignancies don't seem to be seen on monotherapy on low-dose cyclosporin. But those who have had PUVA, ultraviolet A light, who have a lot of squamous cell carcinomas, I think are at higher risk for them getting worse on cyclosporin. So what do you have to watch for? Do follow the electrolytes carefully. You have to add a magnesium level in when you do your blood test for cyclosporin. People urinate out a lot of magnesium when they're on cyclosporin. It's easy to miss. It does cause hyperlipidemia. It is a pregnancy category C, right? There is a large registry of patients who have been on cyclosporin through pregnancy. Remember, if you have a kidney transplant, can't stop the cyclosporin because you're pregnant. And there are patients with psoriasis and inflammatory disorders that remain on cyclosporin during pregnancy. It's not something I recommend. I've done it, but it doesn't make for a very restful night's sleep for a long time. One nice tip, if you see your cyclosporin patient shaking, it means their drug dose is a little high. So if you see them shaking their hands like this, have them skip a dose or two, restart at a lower dose, and remember there are a lot of drug interactions. You monitor blood pressure, it does cause hypertension. You see hypertension frequently. It is not necessarily a cause to stop the drug. It may require you to change the dose or to add an antihypertensive. Sometimes I use amlodipine, sometimes I use Diovan, which is an angiotensin receptor inhibitor. Do watch creatinine. One other tip I can give you that's very important, don't just look at the blood test and make sure everything falls in the normal range. We do that a lot, and that's okay most of the time. But cyclosporin will change your creatinine very insidiously. If someone has got a 0.8 or a 0.7, and the normal range is 0.65 to 1.3, you could see that 0.8 go to 1.2 and never be flagged. Yet you've had a dramatic increase in creatinine requiring a major dose adjustment or discontinuation of drug because you've really reduced their renal function. So follow baseline. Change from baseline, not change out of range. So same idea as I've showed you with the other ones. Definitely do hepatitis serologies. I would consider doing that. Measure every 2 to 4 weeks in the beginning, then monthly, and then depends. I mean, you can do it a little bit longer periods of time as the patient's been on it for longer, but sort of stick to a tighter schedule. So I'm going to finish. Traditional therapies offer us a lot. They're enormously efficacious. They really are helpful. They're relatively safe. They require more vigilant monitoring than the other more modern biologic drugs, but they're there. And they do provide our patients a lot of access. We can get them these drugs pretty easily, and we can expect them to work for prolonged periods of time, particularly methotrexate, where we can use for a lot of years. So thank you for attention. I'll turn it over to Leon, and then we'll take questions.
Okay, thank you, David. I'm gonna sort of pick up where David left, from the old drugs to the new drugs. So when I was in 1990, when I was a resident, I was taught that psoriasis is really a skin disease. As he mentioned, it's the hyperproliferation of keratinocytes, and that's what we treated. Fast forward 30 years, now we know that it's really a systemic disease. It's not a skin disease. It's just that the skin is one of the cutaneous, basically, manifestation of the systemic inflammatory disease, what we see on the skin. It involves comorbidities. It involves metabolic syndrome. It involves inflammation of the adipose tissue. It involves the inflammation of the blood vessels, endothelial cells. It involves the inflammation of joints. It involves the inflammation of liver. So there is this overall systemic inflammation that goes with this disease. And despite that, even though we know that psoriasis is a systemic disease, we are still treating with topicals. And when you look here, and I'm not talking about mild disease or even moderate disease, we're talking about severe disease. Look at the body surface area here, 11 to 20%, 44% of these patients are treated topically. Go back all the way the other side, more than 40% body surface area, 37% of these patients are treated topically. If you look at it a different way and do the math, basically almost more than half of the patients and severe patients are treated topically. 57% of the severe patients are treated topically. Looking in a different way, look at these patients with no treatment. And I totally understand if they have about 2-3% body surface area, yeah, a couple of plaques here and there, you know, no big deal. These are okay, no treatment here. But look here, no treatment, no treatment, no treatment. Even patients with more than 10% body surface area, 39% are going with no treatment. These are really interesting findings, and we should sort of look inward as dermatology providers, and why is that? But that's a whole different topic, and I'm not going to go there. So what do we have that systemically we can treat? What we had was, I think David did such a tremendous job on going over what we had: cyclosporine, methotrexate, retinoids, light treatments. He barely mentioned fumaric acid. Fumaric acid is actually quite widely used in Europe, especially in Germany. It does come with some baggage. It does have some GI upset, diarrhea. And actually, as we speak, there are some new formulations of fumaric acid being worked on in US, hopefully to avoid the GI problems, especially the diarrhea, so that it can get approved in this country. So that takes us to the biologics. So the biologics we have, the old TNF-alpha inhibitors, when I say old, those are the first ones they got approved. They are all approved not only for psoriasis, but for psoriatic arthritis. And the approval is for adalimumab, etanercept, and infliximab. Well, let me put it this way. All the approval for psoriasis are moderate to severe plaque-type psoriasis, except infliximab. Infliximab is approved for severe-type plaque-type psoriasis. And then ustekinumab was approved only for psoriasis until recently, and now it got approved for psoriatic arthritis. So all of the four biologics that we have available today are approved for both psoriasis and psoriatic arthritis. All of them except infliximab is approved for moderate to severe plaque-type psoriasis. Infliximab is approved for severe type of psoriasis. So next, I'm going to show you their efficacy rate. And the efficacy rate that FDA basically has put dermatology a higher bar, and that's PASI 75. And I think, again, Dave did a great job explaining what PASI 75 means, but the same measurement for rheumatologists, ACR 20, for any rheumatology drug to approve for RA. It's interesting that it's ACR 20, which is their PASI, which is our PASI 20, but the bar is much lower for them than us. But anyway, if you look at those numbers, and by the way, in any shape or way, I am not meaning to compare those biologics. You never, ever compare different clinical trials, different populations, different inclusion-exclusion criteria. I just did this slide for convenience sake to put them together, and even I separated the bars to make sure that I am not comparing them. It's not only ethical, but it's scientifically not correct to compare results. But those are all about 12 weeks or 16 weeks or 10 weeks indications that are done basically to get the drug approval. But I always say psoriasis is not a 12-week disease, is not a 16-week disease, is a chronic disease. I want to know what happens at the end of the year. I want to know what happens at the end of the 2 years, because you know those patients are going to be on those drugs for the rest of their life. So when you look at that, and you can see that, again, I did put the numbers together, but not meant to compare. More or less, believe it or not, and depending on what statistical analysis you're doing, because some of those numbers are obtained by what we call, even though they claim that they're ITT or the most conservative way of looking at it, depending on which part of the trial you take it, and if you cherry pick the patients and you drop the non-responders, then you start your ITT in the middle of the trial, then you are cherry picking them, your numbers will be higher. So if you do actually basically ITT from the beginning, most of those, somewhere it's going to be around 50 to 60% PASI 75, more or less, give or take, and they all get around the same place, more or less, at the end of the year or two. Really not much difference between all of those. There are absolutely no head-to-head studies. The only head-to-head study was done by, actually, ironically, Centecor for 12 weeks with ustekinumab against etanercept. And the numbers turned out to be pretty disappointing for ustekinumab. It was about 67% PASI 75 for them, and etanercept was 56%. And that was sort of unpleasant surprise for them, because they expected those numbers would be higher. But regardless, the numbers are more or less somewhere around 50 to 60% if you end up with the correct way of doing the ITT. For example, adalimumab has a data that goes back that they look around 160 weeks, but if you do the ITT analysis, the PASI 75 goes down all the way about 41-42%. If you do the S-treated analysis, it's about 76%, and that was a poster by Kim Papp at AAD. So the bottom line is not much big difference between any of those biologics in the long run. So let's take a look at what's going on in the pipeline. What do we have in pipeline? If you look at in the pipeline, this is what it looks like. It's a whole big mess of a slide here, but the basic point is that IL-17 and IL-17 related products are playing a big role. And that's because IL-17 really plays a very important role in that inflammatory cascade. The problem is IL-17, it's not just IL-17. There is A through E. And E, I believe, is also IL-25, which plays an important role in atopic dermatitis, by the way. But let's forget about that. Let's think about the IL-17, A, C, and F. And that's because how do we know that? If you simply take the psoriatic lesion, involved lesion, and biopsy it, you find high levels of IL-17A, F, and C. Surprisingly, we have recently more information about C, and actually C is expressed 125 times more than IL-17A. So that's sort of some new information. But the bottom line is we're playing with A, F, and C. The other important thing is what we call is the scar of psoriasis. So there was an old study by Jerry Kruger at Rockefeller, did a study and look at the gene normalization. Basically, there are several genes that in psoriasis patients, those are all inflammatory genes, are abnormal. And when they treated them with etanercept over 12 weeks, only some of it got normalized. Most of it stay abnormal, and there was continuous inflammation under the skin, even though lesional skin cleared up. So it's almost like the acne, that there is subclinical inflammation going on as long as those genes are either upregulated or downregulated and they are not normal. So when they did the same study with exisitng, which is IL-17, one of the IL-17 products, there was a higher rate of, you can see, expression of the normalization of these abnormal genes. And I think that sort of speaks more to the root of the problem than just treating the skin lesion. So let's take a quick look at this IL-17 cytokine family. You have A and the F, but they also can be expressed in heterodimers, and you can have the A and F together. And then you have the C separately, and then the rest. Now, we know that A has pathogenic effect on keratinocytes, cause hyperproliferation and acanthosis, as well as the release of the other pro-inflammatory cytokines through the Th17 pathway. So we know that that's been established already. Now, there are three IL-17 products in the market, and those are exisitng, secunumab, and bradulimab. The difference between bradulimab and the other two, exisitng and secunumab, they block IL-17 cytokine itself, and hence, by blocking that, either they blocked IL-17A alone or IL-17A and F dimer, because A and F heterodimer is going to have the A part also, so they can block that. But they don't block the F if the F is alone as a monodimer. On the other hand, brodulumab, it's not a cytokine agonist. It actually binds the receptor itself. Now, the trick there, the advantage of that, both IL-17A and C can use the IL-17A receptor as a co-receptor. So if you block the IL-17A receptor, you're actually blocking not only the A and the AF heterodimer, but you're also blocking the C. So you have a wider blocking ability of the receptor and of those cytokines. So that may have an advantage, but that may not reflect into the clinical practice. So it's interesting to see how that will sort out. Let's take a look at the numbers. This is the brodalumab data, or the name of the study was Amagin. By the way, as a conflict of interest, I have been involved and I'm still involved with all those three studies, all the IL-17 as well. Those are by Eli Lilly, Amgen, and Novartis. Also, I've been involved with the Merck studies, which we'll talk a little bit about that later. So if you look at those numbers here, this is the Amgen study, also known as Amagin. This is the brodalumab. This is the receptor blocker. When you look at PASI 75 at different doses, and at week 12, the highest dose has 83% PASI 75. PASI 90, 70%, and PASI 100 is 42%. So what's amazing here, and really now we're talking about PASI 90 and PASI 100. With the previous TNF-alpha inhibitors or ustekinumab, we did not talk about that much PASI 90 or PASI 100. Remember what we talked about? PASI 50 and PASI 75. So now we're at the PASI 90, PASI 100 levels. And by the way, that's not only unique to this drug. The other two, both secunumab and exunumab, they also have PASI 90 and PASI 100 results, which is really impressive. So here you can see this is a picture from the brodalumab. Actually, this is the lowest dose, 140. And you can see some clearance, by the way, by the end of 12 weeks. This is the Lilly drug, eximumab, you can see at week 12. Again, similar result, PASI 75 is about 82% or so. And that's for both doses, 75 and 150 milligram. And they maintain that at week 20. It's interesting that both 75 and 150 milligram dose get you at the same place around PASI 75 of 82%. But there is a difference now on the dosage. The higher dose did better when it comes to PASI 90, again about 60-65%. And then when it comes to PASI 100, a little bit more than 40%, and that's with the highest dose. So again, we're talking about PASI 90, PASI 100. It's pretty impressive. Just to put them all together here, the brodalumab, you can see PASI 75 is 82%. Eximumab, PASI 75, 83%. Secunumab, that's a Novartis drug, PASI 75 is 82%. They are very, very, very similar. And the same way they're PASI 90 and 100 results, they are very, very similar. Secunumab has done also some studies on the palmar plantar psoriasis, which is really difficult to treat, and they are doing more studies that we're involved with, and that's going to be a value added if those studies turn out pretty efficacious, because palmar plantar psoriasis is really a pain in the neck. It's very difficult to treat. We don't have much that we can use. Now, the other drug that I did not mention so far, it's the Merck drug. That's IL-23, but it's a targeted P19 subunit. Unlike ustekinumab, it targets the IL-23 P40 subunit. This sort of targets the P19, and PASI 75 is about, at the highest dose, 200 milligram, is about 75%, which is a great number. The concern with this medication is it may cause autoimmunity or developing the autoantibodies at a very, very early stage. And that might be a problem. What that means is it's almost like, okay, you inject Botox and then the patient develops antibodies to the Botox and it doesn't work anymore. So we can, that's a possibility. That's one of the baggage with this drug. But again, we're not 100% sure. The numbers are not out, but that's a concern. There's a possibility of that. And if that happens, it doesn't matter what PASI 75 you get at 12 weeks. If you're gonna lose efficacy in a couple of weeks, it's really not gonna be the best thing to do. So that brings us to what else is out there. So we have small molecules now. This is a whole different ball game. They are not biologic, they are not methotrexate, they are not cyclosporine. It's different. We didn't have this before. The hot ones are the JAK-STAT signaling pathways. And just for the next couple of slides, the way they work, it's very complicated. And I'm just going to try to sort of explain this, and hopefully it won't confuse you as much as it confused me in the beginning. But Janus kinases, by the way, JAK stands for Janus kinase, and I will tell you why is it called Janus kinase. It's the members of non-receptor tyrosine kinases. There are more than 500 kinases, and there are only one family, five of them, that has two domains. And by that, what I mean is those are the domains, kinase domains, kinase and pseudokinase. So here you have four of them, JAK1, JAK2, JAK3, and TYK2. The reason why it's called Janus, I guess Janus was the, in mythology, Roman god with two faces. And hence those kinases has two domains, they call them two-faced kinases. Another explanation why they call JAKs, just another kinase. After 500 kinases, really they didn't care and they didn't know how it was gonna work, so they called just another kinase. But I think the real name is Janus kinase. JAK1 and JAK2 are very ubiquitous in all kind of tissue. JAK3 is actually mostly in lymphoid tissue, and it was originally developed by Pfizer for organ transplant rejection. That was originally the purpose of it. It was in the lymphoid tissue. But then they actually developed it for psoriasis that we'll discuss a little bit later. When you look at this, you're going to see that there are two domains, and I think I went over that. The other two domain kinase is GCN2, and those are the only five kinases that has two domains, and it makes them unique. Now, let me try to explain how it works. So the cytokine binds to the cytokine receptor, and they activate those Janus kinases. They phosphorylate. In return, they phosphorylate what we call STAT. And STAT, if I remember correctly, stands for signal transducer of activated transcription. So basically, they get phosphorylated, they get activated, they move to the nucleus, and they exert their bind the nucleus, and basically starts a transcription. And hence, you end up with the pro-inflammatory cytokines. If you stop it at one point, which in this case by binding to the by phosphorylating the JAK, and then that in return phosphorylates the stop, that phosphorylation stops by binding it, then now you inhibit the whole cascade and you inhibit the production of that particular cytokine. This is a very simplest version of what really happens. There are other feedback loops that go in there. There are other receptors, and there are many several combinations that works, because these JAKs, they come in heterodimers also. So what's important here to summarize it, this slide sort of tells you about which JAK and which cytokine is involved. But to us, I think the important one is IL-12 and IL-23, because we know that those are involved in psoriasis. When you look under IL-12 and IL-23, you will see that JAK2 and TYK2 are involved. So if somehow you inhibit JAK2, then you're going to inhibit the IL-12 and IL-23 production, and hence stopping the psoriasis. The other thing is, by inhibiting JAK2, you may play with erythropoietin, which may cause anemia and other problems. So again, nothing is for nothing. You're going to give up something for getting something in life. As usual, there's always the adverse event side effects. So tofacitinib is the JAK inhibitor by Pfizer. It's an oral medication, and it simply works the way that I just explained it. And It's exactly the same way that I explained it. And usually it came around as a JAK3 inhibitor, or it was thought to be a specifically JAK3 inhibitor, and it was actually studied for organ transplant rejection. It turned out that it's not a pure JAK3 inhibitor. It also affects JAK1 and JAK2. And that drug now has actually been not only developed, but FDA approved in this country for rheumatoid arthritis. And now we're studying for psoriasis. However, ironically, it got rejected in EU for rheumatoid arthritis, and the dose in rheumatoid arthritis here in this country is 5 milligrams. We are studying the 5 and the 10 milligram doses for psoriasis. And again, from the conflict of interest point, I am involved with those studies. So when you look at the original study, PASI 75 with 5 milligram twice a day dosing was 44% at week 24 and 68% with the 10 milligram dosing. So it's not a bad number, 68% for PASI 75. And then subjects were able to maintain in 37% of the subjects maintained those results with the 5 milligram dosing, and then 61% of those subjects maintained that result with 10 milligram dosing at 56 weeks. Now, they also compared it to etanercept. You know, ironically, etanercept is like sort of the poor kid on the block. Everybody picks on them. Almost every drug has been compared for non-inferiority. Secunibab has done that. Tofa has done that. I believe apremilast is doing that. So it's ironically, even though I think they do that because it's most commonly used biologic, and probably it has the safest profile among the biologics. But so when they did pick against etanercept at week 12, PASI 75, for 10 milligram dosing was 63%, and etanercept 50 twice a week was 66%. So they were able to show that they are not better than etanercept, but they are not inferior than etanercept. On the other hand, 5 milligram twice a day dosing is inferior than etanercept. It does not work as well. So far, we don't know which dosing is going to get approved by FDA, if any. So that's going to be very interesting to see. That if that happens, if they're going to approve the 5 milligram or the 10 milligram, because remember, as I said, only for rheumatoid arthritis, it's only 5 milligram dosing is approved. And we very well know that skin takes much more medicine than the joints. We know that from TNF-alpha inhibitors. We know that from methotrexate. We know that almost every medicine, skin requires much more medicine than the joints. Now, if you look at the package insert and the baggage that goes with this drug, and this is again for the RA dosing, but it's the same drug. You have serious infections, you have tuberculosis, you have lymphoma, other malignancies. Most likely, is elevated liver enzymes, elevated lipids, and possibly neutropenia. So those are problems. And ironically, you know, if you want to stay away from a biologic to avoid these problems, you're not going to have that advantage with this drug because you're still dealing with neutropenia, serious infection, tuberculosis, all that stuff that you deal with biologics. So I don't know where it's gonna get into the market. The other JAK inhibitor, it's Eli Lilly drug, it's called baricitinib, and it's early phase 2 studies. And if you look at the results, again, on the high dose, it's PASI 75 at week 12. It's a little bit more than 55%, and they were able to maintain that at week 24. So again, for an oral medication, not that bad, but it's early stages. We don't know what's going to happen with that. Finally, we have a totally different mechanism of action drug that's apremilast, and it inhibits PD4. It's an anti-inflammatory. It got recently approved for psoriatic arthritis, so it is out and available commercially. And if you look at the results, PASI 75 is 33%, PASI 50 is 58%, and you're gonna say that, well, those are really not such impressive numbers, and they are not. And you're gonna say that because you're thinking of biologics. this is a whole different class of medication. They are not gonna, it's not gonna replace biologic. You cannot compare apples and oranges. This is an oral medication, systemic medication, small molecule, not a biologic. So please don't think and don't compare it with the biologics when you look at the efficacy results. Think about it, this is somewhere in between, maybe before biologic, after topical, or maybe something before even methotrexate or cyclosporine, because it has a great safety profile. We're not dealing with immunosuppression, we're not dealing with lymphoma. On the psoriatic arthritis label, there is absolutely no lab test required, no monitoring required, so that can become the dream of dermatologists. Let's face the truth. And this might be the dream of dermatologists, and the safety profile is good, and yes, the efficacy is not that high, but on the other hand, why not to try something like this before you go on a biologic? Also, it has some niche, it may have some niche uses. For example, pruritus has significantly decreased. You know, it's interesting. NAPSI score was significant here for the nail psoriasis, which is pain in the neck to deal with, and there aren't that many things that works really well for nail psoriasis. So there might be also some niche uses. So again, this might be a medicine in its own class, not comparable to anything else that's available. Finally, one thing we have to be aware of this drug is GI upset, diarrhea might be a problem, and that just happened early on in the first week or two, and then once you're over that first week or two, it's really not a big deal. Again, from the conflict of interest point, I have been involved with those studies for apremilast with psoriasis, psoriatic arthritis, as well as the lupus. I think I'm gonna stop here because the big boss is showing up at my neck. And if you have any questions, I'll be more than happy to answer them.